Thank you. Can everybody hear me?
Yeah.
I hear myself backwards. Okay. Hope everybody's all right. This is my second session of today, so welcome. I see some familiar faces, some new ones. Those who are familiar are either giving me a second chance to do it right this time or actually enjoyed the last session. I'm not sure, but hopefully you can make it until... this is not the last session of today, actually, so we go on until the drinks, of course, after that. So, those of you who don't know me yet, I am Bas. I work at ING as a chapter lead, and I work there with all kinds of big data and fast data tools. You can find me on Twitter, LinkedIn, Facebook, whatever, whatever you want. And although we're not finished yet, I just got a tweet 5 minutes ago, so that was my last addition to the slides, that the day is already complete. So I don't know who put this on the Twitter, but I thought, okay, now is my final moment of fame, and I got the tweet already that the day is complete. But just as a reminder for this, please rate these kind of sessions and do the organization a favor and give them feedback, because they do a great job by organizing this all together. So today we're going to talk about ETL. And basically, this summarizes the whole presentation. So here it is. There's two options, right, to ETL. You can do it this way, like nice visually and dragging and dropping all kinds of boxes together. Or you could do something else, maybe program some thing in Spark code. And today I want to take you through this kind of discussion. Maybe you've already had it in your own organization, maybe you've thought about it, maybe you've been experimenting with both kind of tools and trying to move some things to Spark. Well, at least I have, and there's no black and white, of course. It will, at the end, we will not come to a conclusion which one is better, but maybe it gives you some help to put this kind of discussion forward in your own organization. So if that's at the end of this presentation, you get a little bit of insight, you get a little bit more depth in this kind of discussion, then I'm happy. Let's start with a definition of ETL. What is actually what we're talking about? I found this somewhere on the internet, which I really like. ETL is just a repeatable programmed data movement, right? Very simple. If you do ETL, you just want to move data around from one place to the other one, and you want to do it not only once, because then you would not write complex ETL tools and statements and manage it and test it, etc. That's too complex. You just probably write a script. But if you want to do it in a professional way, repeatable, testable, then you move to an ETL framework. ETL is extract, transform, load. I think this is also not new to you, but just to be sure, there's three typical phases in ETL. First, you get data from a source system, then you do a transformation. That can be anything. That can be mapping data to a structure that you want to use. It can be enriching the data, filtering, mapping it, all kinds of things you want to do with the data to get it in the right format. Now, typically, for example, if I look at what we do at ING, we have lots of source systems with all kinds of interesting data of our customers, hundreds of them actually, and we want that all the data to be aggregated, to be searchable, and to be readily available for reporting and for real-time analytics, anything that you can think of. But to do that, you cannot directly query the source system. You have to put it in a temporary data storage first, which we call a data warehouse or a data lake. And to do that, we actually have to map it to a structured format. Right, so we actually, our ETL consists of loading on a daily basis lots of batch files which have been outputted from the source system and transforming that into a data lake with a data vault structure. And data vault is a structure, a typical structure of data where you can look in the history of the data and you can actually query data in a like a relational way. So that's very useful. And there's several other use cases that you can think of for ETL. Actually, probably all applications probably do some form of ETL if you have this kind of broad definition, right? All what system is running all in on itself? It's nowadays not much anymore. So anything that involves data movement, data transformation, data migration, or getting data in a database, yeah, you can call it ETL because it follows the same steps. Well, there's software that helps us for that. And if we go way back in time, business intelligence and data transformation did already started 20 years ago or even longer ago, in the 70s. And it's been a very mature field. Yeah, we had relational databases and we had ETL tools that did a job for us. Usually very expensive, but they did a good job. And here's just some examples of these kind of tools that are there. But suddenly we got a movement called big data, right? Hadoop is already 10 years old, so it's not that recently actually. But we could say the last 5 years, this movement is really catching on. And a lot of people and organizations, they look at their ETL tools and they see, hey, I have this very expensive thing, but what's it actually doing? It's only transforming data from one place to another. I can now also do it efficiently, cheaper, with, for example, MapReduce, and now, of course, Spark. And if you look at the broad picture, then this ETL paradigm is actually under pressure momentarily. Because since the Hadoop revolution, we've seen a lot of things changing. Business intelligence became big data. Yeah, some call it a revolution or an evolution, it doesn't matter. It's something new. We approach these kind of things of data analytics in a different way than we did it 10 or 20 years ago. We are not only producing reports that are generated overnight, we're getting more real time, we're getting more data in it, and we call it big data. A data warehouse, which everybody used to have a couple of years ago, is now called a data lake. Again, with technologies based on the Hadoop ecosystem, like HDFS, again, MapReduce, and data ingestion and selection tools, Flume, Big, Hive, Oozy, you name it. Yeah? That's your new ecosystem of your data lake. And you used to have software applications, yeah, the traditional three-layered structure of a user interface, a middleware layer, and a database, but that's changed to microservices and APIs, who sometimes call one database, sometimes call another one, sometimes combine data. They have an intermediate API, and then yes, there's also one front-end, but it's not directly connected to one API anymore. So that's also changed in the last couple of years. But what about ETL? There's not so much changed, right, yet. I mean, probably a lot of you still have one of those tools running that I displayed over there. And I'm not sure why it is, because we can actually move to better or other things now, or we can actually make a choice to keep them, but to combine it, for example, with Spark or another framework. And one step back against those ETL tools, are they obsolete? Well, no, by no means. I don't believe that, because there's still a market for that. But what I find really interesting is that is to look at those kind of organizations and see what kind of choices they are making, to see what IBM is going to do with its data stage tool. What is the vision of Oracle? What is the vision of Talent, of Informatica, and you name all the big ones? What are they going to do? Because they used to have some kind of unique differentiator to sell their product to organizations such as ING. And now these organizations are starting to think more like, okay, I want to have a data lake with a layer of batch and real-time processing, for example, based on Spark. And yes, we want to do some ETL, but what does this new tool bring you? So I think these tools, these vendors, have a choice. They can, for example, say, okay, we still have our own product. It's a core product, including a front-end and a back-end, but we offer you a lot of connectors to your data lake environment, to your Hadoop cluster, for example, but also to a Cassandra database. We offer you anything that you have in your infrastructure. We can connect our tool to that, and by that we still have you. We give you a very, a pleasant to work with ETL tool, where you have a GUI and you can do everything that you want in there. Well, that's a choice. Or you can say, no, actually the current evolution in the technology in the open source technology with things like Spark and Flink are going so fast, we cannot compete against that as a company. So we're actually going to transform our own backend to using that technology. And so some organizations, some vendors are actually doing that. They are replacing their entire backend with Spark. So if you buy their product and you deploy it on your infrastructure, you effectively have Spark running on the backend, even though you might not even know it or you're not interested in that. And another option, I think, is for those kind of tools is to do a kind of step where you say, okay, yeah, we want to use the power of a Spark cluster, which is probably already there in your organization, but we only provide a GUI for that, which it's doing your ETL, and which those tools are very good at, providing a visual overlay. What they do is they, if after you create a job, you can export a job to code, and that code is actually effectively running on your cluster. For example, and I know that Talent, for example, is doing that in that way. They provide you a visual interface, but they only have a thin layer, and once they say, okay, I want to run this model, this ETL job, then they actually transform it to code that you can think of, like a Spark code or even some old Hadoop MapReduce code. Also a choice. So the first question is, you know, if you are in this kind of situation where you want to do something with your ETL tools, what kind of vision does your vendor have and what kind of approach do you want to take for yourself? Okay, a quiz. It's more a survey because I tried to get some science in here, some scientific research, because Elsa thought, well, yeah, I'm just babbling things, but it doesn't make sense, right? I'm coming from a scientific background. If you have a hypothesis, you should actually support it with some material. But surprisingly, in the whole, you know, science community, there's not much research done on ETL. So that's what I'm going to do now. And I will reuse it in further presentations, and we'll get back to that as well. So we just do it by raising hands. Pick one, ETL or L, and I have two questions for you. What do you think, or in your experience, what do you experience in daily work is the most difficult part for developers? So what is that you spend the most effort in getting it right? ET or L? So we start with E. Who votes for the extract phase? Yeah, a few. Okay, who votes for the transform phase? That's a lot. And the load phase? Not much. Okay, well, it makes sense, right? It's the transform phase who wins here. I would also have picked that. On the other side, think about it, because the transform phase is transforming your data. And why is that so difficult? Usually the transform phase in your ETL jobs, if I look at things that is most common, is not that hard, actually. It's only, you know, filtering things. It's only mapping some things to some other things. It's only summing or averaging some data. How difficult is that? That's like one line of code, right? So why is that so difficult? Well, it comes from, you know, all the other fuzz that comes around it, which is data format changes, right? UTF versus ASCII kind of transformation things, testing, data errors, those kind of things. That makes it hard where the data transformation phase is the most difficult. So, okay, you're right on track. But we'll get back to that when I show some Spark code. Second question is, what do you think is the most resource-intensive part in terms of memory management, CPU, those kind of things? Who votes for extract? Nobody. One, yeah. Okay, we should have a talk. Okay, good. Who votes for transform? Some people, yeah, okay. And who votes for the load part? Okay, not so much. I think transform wins again. Yeah, okay, well, I cannot go into discussion with everybody of you, but I would have voted also for the extract phase. And why is that? Well, extract is not only getting things into our tool, whatever you're going to use, but it's also, if you broaden it up a little bit, the export step of your source system, right? If you actually are already in your transform phase, in your ETL tool, you know, look at all the stuff that's been done before getting that data into your system. But it's an export and a data storage step and an import of your data, which is actually very resource intensive. The transformation is usually done efficiently, in parallel, etc., etc. But with extracting data, you get all kinds of troubles like network latency, I/O troubles, those kind of things. So probably extract is the one which is winning here. But okay. But thanks for the survey, and I will scientifically feedback into my next version of the presentation. So when I'm back here next year, then you will see some results actually. To summarize, we sometimes we call this ETL hell. If you work with ETL, and you know, I made some remarks. Why is it so hard? It can only be one line of code. It's because of this kind of problems. I've been working in IT for 10 years now, and most of that in business intelligence and big data kind of environments. And this is just some things I could think of from the top of my head, which makes ETL difficult, and why we should actually be improving it all the time. Now, data is getting out of sync. That's a typical question, of course. If you have any data replication step at all, it will get out of sync, unless you do it very, very well. But you know, ETL, the core of ETL is moving data around, and that means synchronization issues by default. Performance issues, of course, that's always, you know, no matter how fast you can build your system, no matter how many hardware you throw against it, somebody will complain about the performance. That's also a rule of working in this environment. What is, well, maybe not really a problem for us as developers, but certainly a problem for people who are paying the bills and for people who are managing the infrastructure, is that ETL usually comes with a peak load. Eh? We have a nightly batch where we do a load of 6 terabytes of data all at once, and it has to be completed before 7 o'clock, because then some business user wants to see the next report. Yeah, that's not really very efficient, because that means between 3 o'clock and 6 o'clock in the morning, the CPU is on 100% and trying to get all the data right, but the rest of the day is just doing nothing. And that's just a waste of resources. Well, I'll go a little bit faster, but also typical problem of ETL tools is also you have a nice visual overview, right, with all the blocks and the connected arrows. That looks very nice from a high level perspective. But if you drill down, each of those blocks can be customized with lots of parameters and things to check. Or it can even be that there's some hidden VBA code in it, or some hidden Java code or something. And that is just a plain text file sometimes, which is not debuggable, which is not testable, etc., etc. None of you kind of recognize these kind of problems. I've been in bug fixing exercises where after, you know, 1 or 2 days of plumbing through everything, it apparently turned out there was a missing semicolon, something like that, in a Java script somewhere deep down in one of those code blocks. Very annoying. Well, RSC danger, if you work with these kind of visual tools, you should get your you don't touch your keyboard, you touch your mouse, so that's a danger, so beware of that. And yeah, all kinds of other problems, not type safe files. All or nothing approach is also a very typical problem. If you have a you kick off a batch, it fails or it succeeds, yeah, and there's nothing in between. So if you load a data set of 1 million records, sometimes after 3 quarts it stops, it fails, and then you can redo the whole thing. But also lots of room for improvement over there. There's also a movement called no ETL. And is that the future? Because why, you know, why do we go through all these troubles? Because it's, you know, it's a lot of work, it's expensive, there's lots of issues with that and challenges. Why not just keep the data in one place, namely in the source system, and make it available through another way, like a direct API call, for example? And actually, yeah, it seems a bit far-fetched. I also think we're not ready for that. If I look at an organization such as ING, it's by far not ready for such a thing. But some people really consider it the future. So there's a movement going on called No ETL that says just skip the whole ETL part and make sure that all the systems are ready to produce data at any time and have them be responsible for the data and the data quality and the history of the data, for example. So if you want to learn more about this, look at the website noetl.org. In the meanwhile, while we don't use no ETL yet, we can maybe look at Spark. So we have a Spark Summit, so I'm not going to explain what Spark is. But there's lots. If you look at it from an ETL perspective, it really has some advantages. Some of them are listed here. Maybe there's more. But one of the things is that is parallel processing, multi distribution is built in, of course. So it's scale. You have a scalable environment by default. Considering some ETL tools who are only running on a fixed set of servers, and once you scale them up, they get stuck. Or even worse, probably if you scale them up, you have to pay extra licenses for that. Those kind of issues are not there with Spark. That's good. It runs on top of Hadoop, which is probably a data store in your environment anyway. So why just not use the processing power of that to do, for example, those nightly batches that you have, because you have the servers there already. It's just Scala code, or Python or Java, but everybody's using Scala, right? Yeah. Not everybody, I think, but but the advantage is that you have just type safe code. A big advantage of saying that is also what I consider is that you don't have to have really specialized developers who can learn one thing, right? Who can learn only data states or only Informatica, because like good programmers usually are not very interested in that. They want to have more generic skill, such as Java programming or Scala programming, and utilize the framework that are available for that, such as Spark. So in the sense of resource management and attracting talent, this is something that you can offer them. You can say, hey, you do ETL. You're a good Scala developer. Hey, why don't you write your ETL here with us in by making use of Spark. And we can go steps further. We can use other things such as machine learning, the MLlib, which is there in Spark already. So if you want to extend ETL by not only moving data around, but maybe do something interesting with it, for example, making a prediction for your data, why not do it in your ETL step? That's a valid option if you're using Spark, and probably not if you're using a traditional ETL tool that is not, just don't have that capabilities yet. And I think Spark by now is maturing, so you can see now there's pretty good support for all kinds of things that are required in an enterprise organization, for all kinds of tests that you want to do, security related things, monitoring, etc., etc. So it's up to par with a lot of vendor applications. Okay, I have some code examples. I will go through them quickly. For the extract phase, what should that look like in Spark? Well, Spark 2.0, this is actually. You build up a session first, you connect to your local Spark cluster, and what you can do is just read data from a text file, or from a Cassandra database, or for whatever. In this case, I'm using data sets, but you can choose any kind of distributed parallel object structure that you like. You can also use a data frame, for example. But this gives you an opportunity to read directly from a source system. So extract phase is quite simple, actually. And what I do here now is cache it. If you do ETL, the typical thing is that you load it once and then you process it multiple times. So this kind of code is very common in ETL. You load it once. And you have what we call a staging environment or a temporary cache, where you actually have the data available to be reused, offloaded to one database and also to another one. So that's why you should be caching it. So only 3 lines of code and we already have the E phase of our ETL process. Well, transforming, as what I said already, it's defined as doing things with data, like mapping it, filtering, etc., etc. The nice thing about Scala in general, like functional programming, but also, of course, of Spark because it's built in Scala, is that it's functional. So those kind of functions are very well supported and are scalable by default and are, you know, out of the box available in all kinds of data in any data structure that you want to use. So this kind of example, to do a filter on, yeah, I have a data set of customers and orders, not very creative, I admit that, but okay. To do a filter on age and to see if I want premium customers, it's just a matter of writing one line of code. The question is, what do you find easier to read, this or a code block in your visual ETL tool that says that does essentially the same, but is a visual representation of that. A join the same. This is a join of those two data sets, and then we can do, you know, complex things like creating a total sum of all the orders for one customer in this. Also, all things with one line of code. And then finally, the load phase. In this case, I want to maybe load data in a Cassandra cluster. Spark comes out of the box, not entirely out of the box, by the way, because you have to include all the good dependencies from, in this case, the DataStax team, I think. But anyway, it's all there available for you. Set up a connection to a Cassandra cluster from code. Connect to it and write a record in this case to it for inserting data with the CQL language in this case, Cassandra query language. So you've seen some examples now. We can go one step further as well, because we not talked about this, but ETL. Why should it only be E then T then L? Yeah? If you actually look at what you want to accomplish, you want to get things from one data source into another one efficiently, why not just stream it? Or why not just put all the E and T and L steps in after each other? And why wait for the E phase to finish while you're doing the transform, for example? But Spark also gives you that opportunity, namely by using streams. And the nice thing is that a stream is not only a stream that comes from, for example, a Kafka bus, or a stream of click data that comes from an API, you know, somewhere on your front end. A stream can also be a file or another database that you treat as a stream. And Spark has those methods built in, and so it's. Yeah, some vendors consider that the super advanced feature that is now, you know, marketed and that is the new kid on the block, so to say. Well, Spark just has it built in already, and you can just use it in a very simple way, again with one line of code, setting up a streaming context and reading files from, for example, HDFS in this case. So another way to look at your ETL when using Spark. So I wanted to get the discussion started. We've seen some tools, we've seen some Spark with code examples, and which one is better? Eh? That's what you would maybe ask yourself. Yeah, there's no real choice, but what I want to emphasize is that it's not only about the technology, because a pitfall of some organizations is that, yeah, we're going to evaluate things against each other, and we're going to do benchmarks, we're going to do total cost of ownership comparisons, we're going to look at performance characteristics, all kinds of tools. But in this case, that doesn't cover it all, because there's much to choose from, and probably things are balanced. But it is a question about, you know, what do you want to do? Do you want what kind of culture do you want to have in your organization? Do you want people to sit in their desk and look at a visual representation in a GUI, or do you want to have developers who write code? And again, there's no black or white there. You can also have a mixture of those. But that's the discussion probably that is surfacing now. I think with Spark, you have a valid alternative now for traditional ETL tools in terms of enterprise readiness, in terms of performance, scalability, etc. So the technology is not the choice anymore. It's the choice. What do you want to do as an organization? What do you want to give to your users and to your developers? What kind of developers do you want to have in the first place? And one sideways step, what you also should consider is, sometimes do you really need this full Hadoop cluster, ETL cluster for your ETL? If it's just only, you know, a simple summing of data or a simple copy step. And the same goes for your enterprise vendor tool. Do you really need a tool which costs you hundreds of dollars or millions of dollars maybe to do some simple things? Well, this consideration we already talked about. My summary, key takeaways. Pick one. What do you want to do? ETL or maybe ELT or ELTL. Not gone into that too much, but of course that's not fixed. And I talked about continuous ETL as well. So think about those kind of things, because ETL is not what it used to be anymore. You have flexibility now, you have options for that. Second point is what I last talked about. Treat maybe a batch as a stream. Don't, you know, think too much about batch processing, loading a file and then transforming it and then loading it, which takes several hours. Why don't you just do it continuously? Continuous ETL. Also, ETL is not only ETL anymore. Why don't we do ETLP or something? You know, make a step further and do something useful with the data, like making a prediction out of it. And the other ones are, you know, build for scale, automate it if you can, and think about the no ETL thing. Maybe in the future, maybe in 5 years, we'll say, yeah, ETL. Yeah, that used to be. In the past, we used to have some kind of ETL team in our organization, not anymore. All right, I think I'm right on time. So, thank you. And Brian, is there a...
We're out of time for questions, but I'm sure Bas will be happy to take questions from you in the back of the room if you wish.